Good evening. Tonight, in the wake of headlines about the drift away from university, about graduate unemployment and student unrest over grants, we're going to take a look at higher education. Now, the last decade has seen lots more polytechnics and no fewer than 13 new universities. You can get a degree from either. And yet, when we hear so much about the graduate dole queue, is it really worth the paper that that degree is written on? At this moment, almost 3,000 university places are standing empty. Why should this be? In fact, does our whole attitude to higher education need to change? With me tonight is Norman St John-Stevas, newly appointed Parliamentary Under-Secretary to the Department of Education, and an audience of students from all fields of academic life. Could I start, Mr St John-Stevas, by talking about the role of university? What did university mean to you when you were there?
I suppose really it was an opportunity to develop one's own personality, to find out really what I wanted to do, what interested me, and that I think was the most important thing of being at a university. It was a liberating thing. I think schools are rather constricting, and this was an opening up for me. Secondly, I was very interested in my own academic pursuit. I was very interested in history, I was very interested in law, and it gave me an opportunity also to expand my knowledge of English literature. And lastly, I think I just enjoyed it. I liked the activities at a university. I was very interested in politics. I was very active in the union. And it was a very enjoyable period in my life.
Well, do you think that version of the role of a university has changed? Does it apply to 1973 anymore?
I think that basically a lot of that still applies today. I think there are two other things. Of course, if one's looking at the role of the university in general, which one should remember, first of all, there's the necessity, of course, which people have to earn their living. Mm-hmm. So naturally, students are looking to see whether the degrees or the work they're doing is going to help them in later life. And one must remember with universities always, the small minority, but a very important minority of people, who will make the whole of their lives a dedication to learning and to scholarship. Mm. And that's an extremely important minority in the student world.
Now, I mentioned in the introduction to the programme about the expansion of universities, and that largely happened in the mid-60s. People at the time, I remember Kingsley Amis and people like that, saying more means worse. In other words, they were predicting a lowering of standards if university education was spread wider. Has that happened?
I don't think so, no. I think that's always the danger. And one's seen it perhaps in the American educational system, which I know well because I was a visiting professor at the University of California one stage in my career, and I've also been a fellow at the Yale Law School. And one sees there the concentration on mass education has meant not a very high standard. Here I think we've escaped that, perhaps because we've been aware of the dangers, and I don't think there's been any lowering in academic standards. The qualifications that are necessary for entry into universities today are the same as at the time of the Robbins Report, and indeed, in many cases, in practice, you need a higher qualification than the theoretical qualification to get in.
Despite the attractions of university education, you have the two figures, one that I've already mentioned, that there are now 3,000 empty university places, and the report that I was reading about yesterday, that there were 1,000 fewer applications last year than the year before. Does this mark a trend away from university education? Are people getting a bit disillusioned with it?
I think it's too early, really, to draw any very strong conclusion, and one's got to see that figure of 3,000 in the context of 125,000 applications. So it's a small percentage decline, but it is a decline. Perhaps it has something to do with the expansion of polytechnics. This is one of the things in our white paper on education on which we lay most stress, and we have devoted much greater resources to polytechnic education than ever in the past. So this is a reduction, remember, in university applicants. Mm-hmm. It's not a reduction in higher education overall.
But don't you find it a bit discouraging if sixth formers are expressing their belief that they don't want to go on to university? The aim was always to encourage them to go on to university, wasn't it?
Yes, well, I'm not aware that sixth formers don't want to go on to universities, but I think it would be a good thing if sixth formers can say to themselves, where will I be better suited where will what I want to do be better catered for? Will it be at a university? Will it be at a college of higher education? Will it be at a polytechnic? Will it be at a technical college? In other words, that they'll look at the merits of the case, free from preconceived ideas, and won't be misled by a sort of snobbish idea that if we don't get into a university, we've somehow failed, which is quite false, I think.
Well, I'm sure somebody in the audience is going to raise that point. There's another point now, and it's a question which is often raised by people saying, we are, in fact, educating more university people now than we need. I checked today, I asked to find out how many students there now are in London University as a whole, and I was told 63,000, which is a fairly staggering figure. And there are people who say we're educating too many people at university level. Would you agree?
No, I don't agree with that. I think that I remain convinced of the Robbins argument that everyone who can profit by higher education should have it, and I hope we can expand this. I do think this, that those who are graduates will have to be much more flexible in the future than they have in the past. When you had a minority, a small minority, getting degrees, you could almost guarantee people a job. I think that's no longer the case. And I think we've got to get used to the position where many jobs, which in the past perhaps haven't required degrees, will need degrees. This is one of the effects, I think, of spreading university education and higher education over a greater number of people.
Well, let's move to another subject on which you clearly are an expert, and that is priorities. I remember interviewing Mrs. Thatcher when the recent white paper came out, and the emphasis seems to have changed on spending money on primary education. Now, is that being done at the expense of higher education, and if so, is it wrong or right?
No, well, I'm very glad you've asked that, because I think that is a sort of misconception that's going on, that the expansion of primary and nursery education has been at the price of cutting down on higher education. I think the government priorities are right, and I believe that the general public thinks so as well, in that I think the foundations of education are all important, and that it's more important to get those right than anything else, so that her stress on nursery education, I think, has been very widely welcomed. It also, incidentally, helps those children who are in underprivileged homes, because they need that extra help at that age more than anyone else. But the expansion of higher education, of course, goes on. Over the next decade, it won't go on at quite the high rate that it did in the 60s. It went then at the rate of 6.6% of expansion. In the next decade, it will be 5%. But I think one gets the whole thing in proportion when one sees that that expansion of higher education is still twice as fast as the expansion of the school system, which is 3%. It's almost twice as fast.
Well, I do want to explore a number of issues, get your views on them for the
yes.
audience. So let's change again to something else, and that is that amongst a lot of people who've not been to university, there's the feeling that far too many university courses are on pointless things, things which seem to those people not to be important in a country that's perhaps short of doctors, short of engineers, short of school teachers, and so on. I suppose the crude form of the question is, ought youngsters to be allowed that freedom of choice?
Well, I certainly don't think people should be directed into jobs which somebody in 1 year thinks are necessary for the country 10 years later, because those sort of predictions are liable to go wrong. I think one has a duty as an educational planner to see where the trends are in providing places, but I think there should be the widest possible choice for the individual student. And I think particularly at a time of very rapid technological change, it's self-defeating to force a student into a narrow specialism, because that narrow specialism may be relevant for the next 2 or 3 years. After that, it may already be out of date. So this is the great difficulty. You've got to balance the need for specialism with the need for flexibility. And I think people have got to be prepared in their lives over the next decades to change their jobs, to change their occupations, perhaps quite a number of times.
All right, well, having heard your views on a number of subjects there, let's turn to the audience. On the front row here, Mike Terry is the National Secretary of the National Union of Students. What do you have to say to what you've heard? What other particular point would you like to raise?
Well, I was very interested indeed with a lot of the things which you had to say, Mr. Stevas, but there was one thing which particularly concerned me, and that was when you talked about adherence to the Robbins principle that everyone should have the opportunity of higher education they wanted it. I'm sure that you're aware that there's something now like over 40 universities and colleges which on rent strike, that's the students living in the accommodation,
yes,
are unable to continue to pay their residence fees. Mm. And there's a general concern amongst students about the overall level of student grants, mm, and not particularly that, also many of the discriminatory forms of grants awards at the present moment.
Yes.
If you have that idea that there should be that opportunity, surely you must recognise that that must be accompanied by equal and fair financing of students studying in higher education, and that in fact the effect of inflation has been to seriously cut back the ability of many students to continue with higher education. Now, it seemed to me that unless you're really going back to the days which we were talking right at the beginning about, of the days when higher education was the privilege of those who could afford it, and if we really want to have an educational system which is a benefit to the community as a whole, then what, if anything, is the government going to do to tackle this problem? We put in a claim, as you know, for an increased student grants and tackle many of the problems that we see back in October, and the only public response has been that you say that you're fighting back some tremendous trend amongst people in this country who want to see a reduction in student grants, yet all the experience that we have is that people in this country value the system of higher education they have, appreciate that education benefits not just the students concerned but the society as a whole.
Mr. St. John-Stevas, come on back to that.
Well, I think that's a very fair observation, and I think I shall be seeing you actually in another capacity when we meet to discuss this whole question of student grants. My attitude really is this, that I want to see students get a fair deal, and I think they're entitled to it. I think that, on the other hand, if this is to be brought about, one must have the support of public opinion. And that's why I've been concerned about, not about peaceful demonstrations, but about demonstrations that deny the right of free speech, because I think the effects of that is to turn people against students. And unless I have public opinion on my side, I'm not going to get very far. We're spending an awful lot on university awards. We're spending £127 million this year. We're spending £135 million in the next year. And there is a triennial agreement, as you know. But there are, within that system, which was agreed, and which has one more year to run, there are all sorts of anomalies and injustices. I agree with that. And I want to see if we can put them right. You mentioned particularly the case of the high costs in halls of residences. I am worried about that. I'm worried about these rent strikes. And we are looking at this. But you can't meet that, I think, by just a simple increase in the student grant, because the average by which the costs of halls of residence exceeds the notional element in the grant, which is £20 about, is an average. And some university halls of residence are lower, some university halls of residence are higher. So the way we're looking at it at the moment is to see if we can reduce in some way the actual costs of halls of residence rather than making a blanket grant.
May I push on? I know I'd like to come back to you, Mike Terry, and I probably will at this time, but sitting next to you on that front row is Graham Nags, whose short title is President of the Students' Union of the University of Aston, and he knows why I'm not giving the full title. What have you got to say to what Mr. St. John-Stevas has been saying?
Well, I feel that the remark that was made about sixth formers not wanting to go to university, or apparently not wanting to go to university as much as they did in the past, arises from the fact that they have a choice now after they've taken their A-levels as to whether they should go into a job industry on a salary which is appreciably higher than a student grant. Now, I think, and then also at the end of their course, if they did go to university, they realise that there is talk now of graduate unemployment. And so they're assessing their chances as to whether or not it's better to move into industry as soon as they can and work the way up the ladder as far as they can, rather than go to university on the off chance that they might get a better job. And I think that the only way in order that we can overcome this is to make the financing of students at universities and indeed throughout higher education such that they are in opposition to equivalent rates of pay at in industry. In other words, I'd quite simply like to see students on £20 a week, which is what you could get if you went into industry at 18. This is, you know, quite apparent to all students. The only way that students can exist at the moment is either by going overdrawn at the bank during their years and working in the vacation, hoping that they can clear this, or if they're lucky, they've got rich parents. And of course, the net result of this is that people with poor parents end up not going to university because there is no backup facility for them. The government isn't taking into account inflation. We had a review of grants about 2 years ago for a three-year period. And everybody knows how much inflation has increased over the past 2 years.
I think in a way now you're overlapping with what Mike was saying, but you did raise the question of graduate unemployment. And again, on the front row, Ian McKellar is a careers advisor at London University. I mean, is it really a serious problem, this? Is university education orientated in the proper way? Are university graduates, when they come out, much use to employers?
Well, I think most university courses are academic and they are not vocational. If you take out the obvious cases of medicine or the research chemist or the engineer, the vast majority of people follow the pattern of going for self-development. The subject matter of their degree is not of much importance to their employer. And he has to train them. They're not worth as much, perhaps, as the school leaver when they are at equivalent age. And there are a lot of jobs where at the age of 30, whether the graduate becomes the junior manager or somebody else, doesn't depend on his having a degree. If he's used his university course well, he's got the potential to develop and communicate and numerate and the various things that everybody wants. And I think this is what one gains by coming to university. It isn't necessarily a passport to more jobs. You mentioned, had we lowered the academic standards? I don't think we have, but I think we have to lower the job expectation of the majority.
Well, I know that there is, in fact, someone who's got a pretty low job expectation. Alan Howarth, is it?
Yes.
On the second row, you had difficulty, great difficulty, how much difficulty in getting a job since you graduated?
Well, I graduated in December 71. Between December 71 and November 72, I was sort of intermittently on and off the dole. I was taking part-time jobs, labouring jobs, and this sort of job.
Well, what sort of degree? I better ask that. What sort of degree?
I took a degree at Thames Polytechnic in business studies. Uh-huh. I got a 2-2, second-class honours.
Does this sort of situation alarm you slightly, Mr. St. John-Stevas?
But of course, I'm alarmed at anyone who's looking for a job and can't get one. I mean, is this
but
your?
If I may come back.
Is this
on
your situation now? Are you still unemployed, or have you got a job now?
I'm working in a temporary job at the moment. I'm teaching. But the situation which arose for me at the Polytechnic was that I became alienated from the course content. The course served to alienate me from business, from the degree itself, and from I left college with the determination not to enter into the rat race if I could. Mm. This aspect
of it's a comment that somebody ought to this be aware of.
The Polytechnics are loosely termed by the people within the Polytechnics, the students, sir, refer to them as sausage factories. They're just an extension of the business of commerce, and they're there for that reason. And it's no surprise to us, we're living in a system which can't exist without a healthy dose of unemployment, that we should also find ourselves in a dole queue when we leave.
Well, can I make... Mr. St. John-Stevas is not all that happy about the healthy dole queues. I wouldn't have thought you thought a long dole queue was a healthy symptom, would you?
No, I wouldn't have thought so either.
No.
But I think that one's got to see graduate unemployment in the perspective of general unemployment. General unemployment is still far too high, and I'm naturally concerned about that, but the figures show that graduate unemployment is not, in fact, higher than the general unemployment level. And as the general unemployment level comes down, so graduate unemployment is coming down. With regard to what you say about polytechnics, this I don't know about your particular polytechnic, but certainly this is not true of polytechnics in general, that they are in fact sausage factories directed towards one thing. They are in fact directed towards a whole variety of objects, and one of the points of polytechnics is to have flexibility in courses and to have a variety of courses, and people will go to a polytechnic for that reason. The other day I was driving down to Sussex to visit some friends, and I gave a lift to a student. I think he was rather horrified when he found out who was giving him a lift. He was a very good student, actually, to have given the lift to, because he'd been to a polytechnic and had then moved on to London University. And I asked him, well, I said, you're absolutely the corpus delicti. Now, you've been to both. Do you find the university superior to the polytechnic or vice versa? And he said no, he was very happy at the polytechnic, but he went to the university because he wanted a particular course. And I think that should apply both ways.
Can I call in Terry Purvey on the far end of the front row, who is president of the North London Polytechnic Students' Union? Terry.
Yes, I'd like to take up the minister on two things which I see very clearly related, and I'm glad that he has in fact introduced the wider aspects of unemployment, because in what is clearly one of the most class conscious of Tory governments that we've seen this century, we've seen swingeing cutbacks in the living standards of the working class in this country, continuous cutbacks in the social services in an attempt to claw back the living standards of everybody in this country to provide more capital for what was last year, I believe, a record rate of profits in the city. And we are seeing this year the effects beginning really to hit on the students. Government's refusal, apparently, to consider any increase in grants. Their refusal, apparently, to be willing to control prices, not just for the students' sake, but for everybody's sake. And their refusal, apparently, also to be willing to act in the case of unemployment, which, as the Minister rightly points out, has within it the factor of graduate unemployment.
Well, silly old me to have widened the issue. I would have thought that, in fact, in the Prime Minister, whom we must take as summing up the government, in fact, you have perhaps the most classless Prime Minister, in fact, we have ever had.
And say that, Mr. Stevens.
I'm another totally classless figure, as you realise. if one looks at the government economic policy, it is directed at the moment to helping the lower-paid workers. I don't think that thesis is really justified, but I don't think really we ought to pursue it, because we ought really to concentrate more on the educational field.
Yeah, well, that's right. I was just, in fact, going to come to you. Gerald Bailey, is it?
Yes. Indeed.
In you come, then.
I think you're disguising the fact that higher education today is extremely dishonest. It's a PR job both by schools, it's a PR job by universities and colleges. Myself, I feel that this dishonesty is summed up in the fact that I, typically, and many others, probably come to the end of this so-called invigorating, enlightening experience, totally disillusioned, and inevitably forced into a small choice of employment. So we have two options, we opt in or we opt out. Some of us opt in, some of us opt out. But to me, this is a gross waste of resources. And I went to one of the most flexible universities in the country, and even there, this kind of academic elitist myth continues. It seems to me it won't be until the day that university and colleges are opened up to the whole section of the population to educate them, liberate them, whatever terms you wish to use, at any time they choose in their lifetime, are you going to get this situation in any way altered? I think government policy continually is too narrow-minded in concentrating on cramming education for whatever value they see fit into this narrow band of education from when one's 18 to 21. I had to take a rapid gamble, invest now when my friends are all had jobs and cars and so on, and hope to come out with something at the end. And now I feel perhaps I made a mistake.
Well, do you, in your work as a minister, have too much detail to contend with to look at that sort of long-term view of education, that long-term philosophy of education that Gerald Bailey just put there, that universities should be thrown open to everybody at any time?
No, I hope that I can get my head above the sea of paper that does threaten to engulf one. We've got far fewer ministers in the Department of Education than under the previous government, but there seems to be much more work. But I don't think that blanket indictment really is justified of the system. Of course, any individual may have an unfortunate experience in education and may be disappointed, but I think it's totally exaggerated to say that those who are teaching in the universities, those who are teaching in the schools, are only concerned with a public relations job. I think that people go into teaching because they feel it's a vocational pursuit. And the vast majority of teachers, both in universities and schools, are in fact dedicated people, not earning, I think, as much as society as a whole should be prepared to see them earn.
Yes, indeed. Let's ask the careers officer. Is there any detailed evidence that graduates are satisfied? And I'm sure over a longitudinal studies, there haven't been any done, I don't think, for any period of time, and I'm sure they're not satisfied.
Well, I was going to ask Shirley Munro, but I will accept your guidance, and I will ask Mr. McKellar.
Well, I think the vast majority of people get a job because it fits their personality and their self-concept. And this is probably what they've gained at university. If you don't use your degree subject, then you're getting your job because of what you can give and what you get out of it. And I would think that those that find the right niche, in fact, have been very much helped by being at university.
Let me push over to Sherry Munro in the red on the front row there. You're what is charmingly called a mature student at a teacher's training college. In view of what Gerald Bailey has just said behind you, I mean, do you see yourself as being conned into being a cog in a yet greater con game? Are you going to go on conning people?
No, I don't think so.
Well, what do you think you're going to do?
Well, I think mature students, could I just classify that, are students between the age of 25 to 49.
And you're nearly 25.
Yes, and they come into the profession. They've done other things before, and I think they come into teaching because they generally want to teach, and therefore they know what they're going in for.
But do they not have any doubts about the system, of the sort that Gerald Bailey expressed?
I'm sure they do have doubts, yes, but I think that their views are quite different.
Right, now could I push back onto the second row? I think it's Peter Cox from...
Mary's Hospital.
That's right, off you go.
Yes, I think one of the problems of graduate unemployment is that not enough students from school and about to go to university have any idea about what they really want to do. And therefore, they have no vocational direction, such as we were lucky enough to have to go into medicine and so on. And I think one of the problems lies at two levels. One is at the school, where careers information could be a lot better so that the students are vocationally directed. And the second is at the university entrance level, where the universities would be more willing to accept mature students, and the local authorities would be more willing to support mature students who may have left school and gone and done something else and really found out what he wants to do.
Before I ask Mr. St. John-Stevas to come back to the points that have been raised, there are, in fact, on the third row, two girls, let's get your names right, Linda Audsley and Julia South. Yes, you both at Mayfield Comprehensive. Now, do you feel the lack that Mr. Cox has just mentioned, of any guidance at all? Are you thinking of going to university?
Yes, I am.
You are?
I'm not, no.
Why are you not? Is this because of home economic circumstances or because you are a bit disenchanted about it?
Yeah, I am disenchanted, and I also think that there's a hell of a lot of money spent on university and that it could be sort of put into better use, because as some of the other students have said, they come out with a degree and they don't have a job. But if they were geared to having a job, then the students would be, you know, it would be better.
What sort of job are you thinking of taking if you're not going on to university?
Well, I'm not thinking of a job at the moment.
Are you not getting any vocational guidance? Is in fact
no,
what
the
Peter
career,
Cox was
the
saying
careers,
right?
I do agree there that the careers people at our school aren't that efficient.
Well, all right, you've got to answer that when you go back on Monday. Good. Could I ask Julia, who is next, while the microphone is over there? You said you do want to go on to a university.
Yes.
You don't share her doubts at all. Can you tell me why?
Well, I think 3 years at a university are very valuable years in your life, and I think everybody should have the opportunity. But I don't think that it need come after school. I think if we all had a bank of time, a credit, and we could come back whenever you felt you could benefit most from the time. And so it could be at 30 after you've seen, you know, life without university. I don't like this.
And it did happen to a lot of people after the last big war thing, when they came in very much later than they normally
would. Apparently they were the best students that the people had at those universities.
Mm. Well, what do you say to that sort of flexibility in the system, Mr. St. John-Stevas?
Well, there have been a number of very interesting points raised, particularly about the Youth Advisory Service, the Career Service in schools. I would hasten to say that isn't my responsibility, Linda. Mustn't blame me for whatever shortcomings there may be, because my responsibility is confined to the university and higher education. And there, I had a meeting only the other day with the appointments officers of the various universities, and we are working very close touch, and that I think is working well. I have had criticisms of the career service, and of course we're always trying to improve the thing. I think you should, though, allow for the difficulty. Many people leaving school simply don't know what they want to do, and it's very difficult, I think, for those who are concerned in this work to direct people intelligently, because the students themselves are frequently all at sea. Well, I very much agree with the point made by Linda, that one shouldn't regard education as ending with the university or ending with a polytechnic, that one must move towards the position which they have in France, what they call education permanente, if I may
You said that very well. Will you tell us what it means?
Permanent education, ongoing education, so that one's education goes on throughout life. And we've got a report on further education coming out, the Russell report. It'll be published soon. The Open University, of course, which I visited with Mrs. Thatcher the other day and which was praised by the Prime Minister yesterday in a speech, that is contributing there. And I'm certainly immensely interested, you asked me about forward thinking, in this area, as to how we can create a society where people who have missed out their chances for higher and further education can get it later, and how those who, like yourself, will go to a university for a certain number of years will have the opportunity later to pursue those studies again, or perhaps some other branch of studies in which they might have become interested.
We're running out of time, so what I want to say to the viewers is a quick good night and a warning that we are carrying on with the programme, with the discussion. I did have some. Well, there are three people in a row. Now, you've had one, Mike. The gentleman on the third row, yes, with the dark glasses.
Yes, I'd like to, first of all, put into perspective Mr. Stevens, the fact he gave us that they've spent £127 million on student grants every year. I believe that's what he said. Well, I think that's quite adequately covered by, for instance, the last arms deal with Libya, which provided something like £500 million. The other thing I'd like to raise is the question of self-defeating specialisation, I think was the phrase that you used. And are you aware?
Self-defeating specialisation.